Welcome to Talk Me Healthy. My name is Sherry Keating, founder, Diabetes Care Consulting. The goal of Talk Me Healthy is to provide you education on how to live your best life every day starting today. Each show will bring a different health-related topic and exciting guests to share their expertise, passion, and personal stories. My hope is you will hear something that motivates you to make a small step towards living a healthier, happier life. Hi, welcome to Talk Me Healthy. This is Sherry Keating, and today's show is about cancer. I'm sure many of you, or most of you, actually have been either personally or know somebody with cancer. So today's show, we're going to talk about cancer, we're going to talk about personal stories, we're going to talk about hope, we're going to talk about prevention, screenings, and resources. So my guests today are Adam Smedberg, the community manager for the Greater Gardner Relay, and my good friend Sheila, who is actually going through cancer treatments right now for stage 4 colon cancer, and she's agreed to come on the show. She's actually having chemo, and we're so grateful that she's come on the show today to talk about her personal journey. So thank you so much, both of you.
Thank you.
For coming on and sharing this information with our viewers. I just wanted you to notice that we're wearing purple shirts today. Adam is wearing his in support of the Greater Gardner Relay for Life. I'm wearing mine because I am personally a cancer survivor. I had a very rare fingernail melanoma in 2008, and I am happy and blessed to say that I am almost 9 years in remission, and I'm very grateful for my team at Mass General, for my family and friends, and for my faith that got me through that very difficult journey. And Sheila is also a survivor. She had ovarian cancer, and she is a survivor, and so we're wearing our survivor t-shirts in to celebrate. Now I'd like to talk to my first guest, Adam. Adam, can you tell me why you became involved in the Relay for Life, how long you've been involved, and what your role is?
Sure. First of all, thank you for having me on the show.
Oh, you're welcome. Thank you so much for being here.
Absolutely, Sherry. So I've now been involved. I'm going into my fourth year with the American Cancer Society. I got involved with the American Cancer Society because of my personal history with cancer. I've had 3 of my 4 grandparents were all diagnosed with cancer. I lost a grandfather to kidney cancer and my grandmother to pancreatic cancer. Mm-hmm. And I was about 16 years old when we lost her, and actually was there when we lost her. So it was a very touching moment, mm-hmm. but something that very much lasted with me. Mm-hmm. So, I got involved because it is so personal to me and something I really want to see eliminated because it is in my family. The programs that we do here with Relay, what I'm in charge is working with these communities to help them get a better understanding of what we do with ACS and the work that the American Cancer Society is doing, but also helping them, you know, have successful events, helping the relays out any way I can to help recruit folks or individuals who are also invested in seeing an end to cancer and, you know, helping them find the resources they need to be successful in this battle. So
that's, you know, my grandmother died of pancreatic cancer, mm-hmm. and they actually think there's a link between her pancreatic cancer and my fingernail melanoma.
Really?
Yes.
Okay.
I don't know how that can be, but that's what I've been told. So.
Well, I have heard, you know, some people have speculated that some cancers will skip a generation, and so that may be something there.
Mm-hmm.
I can tell you right now, we are seeing a survival rate now that is unprecedented with cancer. We are saving more than 500 lives a day due to the research and screening programs that we have in place to help people get taken care of now. And it that's incredibly important. You know, here in Massachusetts, we have a phenomenal hospital system. Between Mass General, Brigham and Women's, the hospital systems we have in Boston, the universities we have that are doing medical research with Harvard and Tufts, it's unlike anything we see nationally. You know, most states, we may be able to fund, say, 10 or so grants. Here in Massachusetts, we're funding over 80 grants.
Wow, that is wonderful.
Yep, including Dana-Farber. We actually fund over 16 research grants with the Dana-Farber Institute. So we are, you know, very much on the forefront of cancer research.
Well, we do live in an awesome place where Boston is only an hour away from here, mm-hmm. and we are at the hub of medicine in Boston, so we are really fortunate.
Yes, we're very fortunate with what we have. And, you know, the people here in the state understand too. You know, people are, you know, very much in the know as far as getting screened and getting taken care of. You know, having the affordable health care program that we've had prior to the National Affordable Care Act has allowed a lot of people to get screened and get looked at, you know, that may not have been able to afford it beforehand. Mm-hmm. So we are doing a much better job of trying to catch it here in this state.
So let's talk about the screening, because I know that May is Skin Cancer Month.
Yes.
So tell us a little bit about what type of screenings that people should be doing for skin cancer, and then other screenings to prevent cancer.
Absolutely. So, you know, as you said, mentioned, this is May is Skin Cancer Awareness Month. And unfortunately, skin cancer is the highest diagnosed cancer here in the U.S. We actually see more skin cancers than all the others combined.
Now, when you say skin cancer, you're talking about melanoma, or are you talking about basal cell, or
all of them? All included. Of them. Yes. Mm. It all kind of fall under that umbrella.
Okay.
So, so we are seeing, you know, but we are, you know, working to really educate the public in, you know, making sure you're wearing a hat, making sure you're got your sunscreen on when you're going out, you know, try to find shade, you know, especially in those beach areas, you know, or where you're at. Fortunately now, we're seeing much more with the sunscreens where not only are they stronger, but they're also more waterproof. You know, mm-hmm. We've seen that over the last several years. Whereas before, if you put it on and then went in the pool, it ended right. up with the chlorine. So, right. so we are starting to see more of that. But, you know, absolutely see your doctor on a regular basis. And if you're, you know, when you're going for your physical, if they see something, don't ignore it. You know, go to see a dermatologist, get it looked at. You know, it's too important not to. I've had a couple of family members who have recently had them found marks on their skin and have had those looked at and have them removed. So, you know, it's just too important for us not to take those, you know, see those, get those physicals done and really take that seriously what they tell you.
And if you have a family member with it, you're at a higher risk. Mm-hmm. So even though you don't have any spots that may look suspicious, you should probably still get screened.
Yes.
Correct?
Yes. You should still be seeing, you know, when the doctor sees you for your physical, if they see a mark that, you know, wasn't there last time or that they look suspicious, you know, definitely go see your dermatologist, and get it looked at. Get those spots, you know, looked at. If they have to be removed, get them removed. You know, it's just too important right now.
Absolutely. And my melanoma on my fingernail was not related to the sun. Mm-hmm. But now I'm at a higher risk for the sun melanoma. So staying out of the sun, those hot times of the day between 10 and 2, hat, sunscreen, umbrellas, all of those things, really important.
Absolutely. You know, and, you know, New England summer day, mm-hmm. you know, it can get hot out there. You know, make sure you're keeping yourself protected. You know, we've got Memorial Day weekend coming up here. Mm-hmm. You know, people love to go out and barbecue and have a good time. Just be smart about when you're out in the sun, you know, and being smart about how much exposure your skin is getting to the sunlight.
I think people don't think about winter sun, too. When you're driving in your car mm-hmm. and the sun is on your windshield, you're actually being exposed
yes.
to the sun as well. So that's something else to think about. You really need to wear your sunscreen all year round,
yep.
not just in the summertime when it's hot outside. Yep. So what other types of screening besides skin cancer screening should we be thinking about, and also what are the times that we should be having those screenings mm-hmm. done?
So, you know, for women who are over the age of 45, you know, should be looking at getting their mammograms done on a yearly basis and going in and having the doctors look at that for breast cancer. You know, October is very popular as far as where you're paying for breast cancer, and that is a very critical thing for women to make sure they're getting checked out on. I know we're going to talk a little bit more about colon cancer in a little bit.
Yes.
So, mm-hmm. But, you know, we do encourage anyone who is over the age of 50 to be they don't necessarily have to go in for the colonoscopy, but at least have a FIT-CART test. And what that is, it's a cotton swab test that they do. The doctors send it home with you. Mm-hmm. You get it, you do it at home, and you send it in. And, you know, that's how they can determine whether or not you need to go in for a colonoscopy. And you should be doing that at least once a year after the age of 50. And then with the colonoscopies, you know, typically about every 3 to 4 years, you should be going in to get those done again after you hit the age of 50.
The other thing with the colonoscopy, I know as a nurse, if you have a polyp, it's more often. It's usually yearly, isn't it?
Yes. I mean, it's going to be at the doctor's discretion. Mm-hmm. You know, my mother had, they found a polyp with her, but she hasn't gone in recently, but she does know that she's at risk, so she has the FIT-CART test.
Okay.
And so she's doing that now, so she can, you know, they can at least do that test and then see if she needs to go in for the colonoscopy.
Is that the new trend now, the FIT-CART versus having the colonoscopy?
Yes, because it's less invasive. It's, okay. You know, it's a cotton swab test that they do, and then they send that into the lab. The lab checks it out, and then they send it back, the results, to the doctor. And then if you do that on a yearly basis, the doctor will have a better baseline to see what needs to be done from there.
And you do it at home?
Yep.
The doctor's office gives you the kit, you take it home, you do it, you send it in.
Yes.
Easy.
Yep.
And insurance covers that.
Absolutely.
Perfect. Okay, yep. Great.
So those are the major ones that people should be looking at and having done. And then, you know, as you know, not necessarily screening, but some of the things that they're looking at with children that we just announced in this past year is the HPV vaccination with children between the ages of 11 and 13, both boys and girls. Getting the HPV vaccination for not only testicular and ovarian cancers, but also mouth cancers.
I was just going to say throat cancer. I actually have a good friend who had the HPV virus and it caused throat cancer.
Yes.
And her brother passed away of throat cancer and she was diagnosed with throat cancer. And so that's very important. I'm glad you brought that up.
Yep. And that's the results that we just came up. We were just, our researchers that ACS funds really kind of stepped through last year and really kind of came through with that breakthrough that it needs to be. And the reason they say between the ages 11 to 13 is that's when the antibodies for those areas are being generated the most for children of those ages.
Okay.
It becomes now a teenager, you know, 15, 16, 17, 18. If they were to get it, it's going to be less effective. So,
so those are the key prime times.
Yes. 11 between to 13. 13. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah,
my granddaughter's 10, so I want to make sure that she has that test next year.
Yes.
It's a shot?
It's a vaccination.
Okay. Yeah.
And that's just, it's important. You know, it's important for children, and it's important for parents to understand that it's not a stigmatism for boys. You know, the big thing was coming out with the boys needed to have it done too. In the past, it's just been girls who are at that age. Now that we're really finding out that it's the boys who need to have it done as well.
Okay. All right. Well, that's really good information for our viewers to find out. So thank you. I just want to talk to Sheila right quick because I want to bring Sheila in because she actually has cancer in her colon. And so can you share with us a little bit about where you're at today, how you ended up with colon cancer, and about your previous cancer?
Sure. Hi, I'm Sheila. Thanks for having me, Sherry.
Oh, thanks for coming. I know you probably don't feel well because you're having chemo right now.
Yeah, I'm in the midst of treatment right now. This is an infusion system, and so it's connected here to a port, and I go home with it for 22 hours.
And that's after you have chemo at the oncology center?
Yeah, I have chemo for about 2.5 hours, and then they connect me to the infusion pump.
And how often do you need to have that done?
I'm going every other week for treatment.
How do you feel?
I was up last night. My pump was malfunctioning, so I'm a little tired today.
Mm-hmm.
And I have if you notice my face is red, it's from the steroids. So
you have to have steroids when you have your treatment?
Yeah, it just helps with nausea and accepting the chemo.
Okay.
Drugs.
All right. So you initially had ovarian cancer.
Yeah.
And how was that diagnosed?
2012, I had the opposite of a period. So it was like 3 weeks, you know, I'd be bleeding and then 1 week off. And so I knew something was going on because I'd already gone through menopause.
Okay.
So I went to the doctor and they did, you know, an ultrasound and they saw the tumor. That was a pretty good sized tumor. So I went to UMass Memorial and had a hysterectomy. And I haven't had an issue with that. But that was 2012.
Now, was that all the treatment you needed? Was just the hysterectomy, and then you didn't need chemo radiation?
It was a rare form of ovarian cancer, so it doesn't respond to chemo drugs. So it was, you know, it's just a monitor kind of thing.
Okay, so you went into remission for that. Because my doctors at Mass General tell me, you never can say you're cured.
Right.
You're in remission.
Right.
There's a highly likelihood that you're not going to have a recurrence, but they can never say you're cured. Is that correct?
Exactly.
That's correct.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
So what happened from when you were in remission for your ovarian cancer until now you have colon cancer?
Well, you know, I was getting my yearly checkups and I was at the doctor, and I had some insurance issues during that period. And so, you know, I said, do you think I should get a colonoscopy? I don't know why I just asked that, because I didn't have it at 50 when I was supposed to have it. I did have the ultrasound in 2012, and there was nothing on my ultrasound except for, a little gallstone. So nothing showed up in 2012. I did the swab.
The thick hard test.
That was last year, and nothing showed up on that. And so this past summer in June, at the end of school year, I was just having problems, like with, I go hiking with my youth group, and I would only be able to walk like 100 feet, and I'd be like sick to my stomach and out of breath, and I thought I was just out of shape, But then I would just climbing my stairs with something in my hand would cause me to be out of breath. So, I just was kind of keeping an eye on it. And then I started having some back pain. So I thought it was like a kidney stone or something like that. And then one weekend it got really bad. So over the summer I was just sort of monitoring it. I'm really bad. I only like to go to the doctor when I'm sure something's wrong with me. So
I'm sure
I don't want to go there for nothing.
You and many other people are. So hopefully viewers that are listening, I hope you're really listening to Sheila's story, because there's a very important lesson in her story.
So in August, the beginning of August, I had one weekend I had back pain and like ice, heat, nothing would touch it. So, I got an appointment. And then that doctor ended up canceling. She was sick, so, they knew I sounded disappointed on the phone, so they're like, how about, you see this nurse practitioner in, I think it's Baldwinville? And so I went up there, and I actually was with a student, and, for a while, and then she came in, she goes, you don't look good. And I'm like, I don't feel good. And she goes, let's do some blood work. And my hemoglobin was 7.1. It's supposed to be like 12 to 16.
Mm-hmm.
So I was actually in the heart attack range by that point, when it gets that low. I just automatically got iron. And then my friend is a radiologist. And so I couldn't get an appointment they wanted me to see a GI specialist, and I couldn't get one until September. And sometimes I just get urgencies. I feel like an urgency.
Mm-hmm.
And so,
like
I kind of talk to people.
Like
I need to see someone earlier.
Mm-hmm.
And so I ended up talking to my friend, the radiologist, and she got a GI specialist in Westminster to see me. And he did the colonoscopy. So he laid it out, like what could happen. And I'd already done my research because I'm the Google doc, Dr. Google. I go there. And so I just had a feeling it was colon cancer. I can't explain it. And he woke me up after the procedure and said, it's what we thought it was. It's actually the term is called colorectal cancer now. That's the official term, because it includes rectal cancers as well as colon cancer. So they combine it all.
Okay.
So it was a whirlwind from there. I found out she was able to get me. Well, I went to see some doctors at Mass General, and they confirmed what the oncologist, I'm going to Haywood Hospital for my treatments. So they confirmed that, I was inoperable at the time. I'm stage 4 colorectal cancer.
What does that mean, that you're stage 4?
Stage 4 means it's metastasized to like other organs. I had a spot on my lung. I had a spot on my liver. I have numerous, I'm doing really good. But I had numerous metastases outside my peritoneum. And when they're outside the peritoneum, you're not eligible for surgery. So, it was the only thing that could help me was chemo. So I'm on a chemo treatment of FOLFOX, and I'm going to Haywood Hospital, and I can't say enough about the nurses up there and how supportive they are. And this is Nurses Week, so
you know, thank you to your nurses. Yeah, it's so important to have a great team and one that you trust and that you're comfortable, because you have to go every other week.
Yeah.
I feel the same way with my team and Mass General. They were amazing.
I used to be there 6.5 hours because I was on something called oxaliplatin, but that was causing neuropathy in my fingers, and I was like couldn't open my toothpaste and stuff, so they kind of dropped that for a while. And I get something called a CEA, which is a something antigen, but the E stands for. But that tells me like the tumor growth. So it was, I was actually in the average range at 3.3, but the last time I had my CEA was at 4.1.
So what was your CEA when you were diagnosed with cancer?
169.
169, and you went down to 3.3. Yeah. That is awesome.
I have about 15 treatments so far.
And have
it's been 9 months, so it goes by really fast.
It does go by fast. Sometimes. Sometimes it feels like it's really slow. Other times it feels like it's fast when you're looking back. But have they repeated a CAT scan? What have they?
I have a CAT scan. I had a CAT scan in February, and they said my tumor was unrecognizable at that point, and that a lot of the metastases had resolved. There were still some in there. And I have another CAT scan. It's usually every 3 months where they do the CAT scan, so I have one actually next week to see you know, what's going on.
And you know what? That's the great thing about the Relays for Life, not just Gardner, but all the relays across the country, because the money that is donated really does make a difference in people's lives in terms of treatment options. I know my cancer actually was not a curable cancer. It didn't respond to chemo or radiation either. I had my thumb amputated because the tumor was in the fingernail, and the only option was interferon, and I was very sick with the interferon, and actually I wasn't able to tolerate all of the required treatments. So that was the only options. But now, because of research and being in Boston, there is actually 5 new drugs and maybe more that people have options. So it makes a huge difference. And the Greater Gardner Relay, isn't that one of the biggest relays?
It is. This past year was the 14th largest in the nation. And it's all North Central Massachusetts that really comes together. I mean, we have teams from as far west as Athol, all the way to Lunenburg, from Ringe all the way down to Rutland, Princeton area. So we have a huge amount of folks who come. We had last year just almost 2,000 folks registered for the event. Over 550 survivors that attended, and so it is such a an amazing event. And last year, with our theme last year was it was a Dr. Seuss theme, and the community that came together for it absolutely blew it out. I mean, there were Thing Ones and Thing Twos and Grinches and Cat in the Hats all over the place. This year, our theme is Rock Out to Knock Out Cancer. So I'm fully expecting to see spandex pants and Elvises and, you know, hair bands galore. So, you know, for as much as this is an event that where we do remember those that we've lost, we, you know, honor those who have fought this battle. We also try to have as much fun as we can, because we want people to, you know, part of the, one of the slogans that we used to have was celebrate, remember, fight back. And we want to celebrate. We want to have people to come out and just experience, you know, what it's like, you know, to just enjoy being there with some, you know, as a survivor, you know, having your family there with you, you know, as a caregiver, someone who was there to support a survivor throughout their journey, you know, knowing that there's so many people that are out there to support you, especially here in the Gardner area. So that is truly, you know, one of the more amazing aspects of the Relay for Life event.
I actually have, when I was diagnosed in 2008, a friend of mine said, oh, you got to join the relay. Well, I didn't know what the relay was. And so I did join the relay, and my first year walking in that survivor lab, I'm telling you, it brings me to tears today. Every year I've walked that survivor lab since then. So for the past 8 years, and I will be there again this year to walk that survivor lab, and I walk it very grateful and just blessed to be a survivor.
My mom has walked the caregiver lap with me many years, and my family has come out. And if you have not experienced the Relay for Life, you've got to come just to be there and see the hope and just the celebration of being a cancer survivor and the gratefulness of people who have been taken care of by caregivers and all the... It's just a great time. It's so emotional. We remember those that we've lost. My dad had cancer, and we've lost him, not from cancer, but he had prostate cancer. And it's an incredible experience. So I recommend highly everyone to come out and participate. If you've never done it, you need to do it. And if you're a survivor, there's so many things going on for survivors. Tell us about the survivor events.
You know, the survivor events, it's so touching when you're at those. We actually had a survivor dinner a couple weeks ago. Faith Lutheran Church in Gardner does this spaghetti dinner for our survivors. And, you know, I had a chance to greet them. We did two seatings, and seeing the people there, you know, getting a chance to talk to a lot of them, many of them catching up for, you know, who I haven't seen probably since either last year's relay or, you know, before then, and just getting a chance to talk to people and then greeting them. It's so touching because they, you know, they now become part of this bigger family that you create really with this. And for them, this is, for all of our survivors, all of our caregivers, this is part of their, I don't want to say routine, but it's what their...
Their journey.
Yes.
I like to call it a journey.
That's a great way of putting it. So, you know, so we've got an event coming up in a couple weeks over at the Westminster Senior Center. They're calling it the Malt Cafe, going with our Rock Out to Knockout theme. They're going to be doing some 1950s snacks and drinks and things like that that survivors can come over and join us for. That'll be on June 1st.
Okay. What time?
I believe it's at 5:30.
Okay.
Over at the Westminster Senior Center.
All right.
Beautiful new building that they've just built there right off of Route 2.
Okay.
And then at Relay. You know,
that is, what's the date of the Relay?
Relay this year is June 9th and 10th. So that's a Friday, Saturday. We're right out at, if you haven't been there, we're right there, right next to Green Street at Mount Wachusett Community College, where the track football field is.
Behind the fitness center.
Yes, yes, great way to put it. I do recommend if you are coming to park behind the school. There is some areas in the front, but as we have had a history with Mother Nature, not always agreeing with...
I have walked many, many laps in the pouring rain and the freezing cold. So we're hoping for sun this year.
Yes, yes. We're finally due. So, because there are some spots in the front, but with there are grass. So I always tell people, please try to park in the back behind the school. We do have golf carts that will come out and get you and bring you over if you need help with that. And the survivor portion, the survivor reception will start at 3 o'clock. The survivor lap will start at 6, the survivor opening ceremonies, I should say, start at 6, and then the laps will start right after that. And we've got a big tent that the survivors get to come in, and great reception that they put together. We have a photo booth this year that the survivors can get photos with their caregivers and loved ones. We got the props to go along with it. It's going to be a blast.
And also every year they have the banner and you sign the banner and put your cancer, the date you were diagnosed, how long you've been in remission. And every year I put my thumb as a reminder with my name and all of that. They always have entertainment.
Yep.
They always give us a little gift. We have our survivor t-shirts. It's just such a great thing to be in the same room as people that have gone through what you've gone through. It's just great camaraderie and support and celebration.
You touched on it right there, you know, the camaraderie. You know, when you have this many survivors, this many people have gone through all these treatments. We have a survivor who's on our leadership committee. She's a 36-year survivor. And wonderful lady. She's actually one of the first ones to start up the Gardner Relay. And she reminds us just what the difference is, what she went through 36 years ago compared to today.
Even just in the 8 years I've been in remission, it's unbelievable the progress that has been made in just the 8 years. It's awesome.
Well, and that's, you know, a good part of it is that we have the treatments here in Boston. We have, I should say, we have the facilities that are trying more and more cutting edge treatments. Mm-hmm. We talked a little bit a while ago about the grants that we fund here in Massachusetts. Yeah. Well, the researchers that we fund are your typical right out of college, brand new, young, new ideas. Mm-hmm. These are people who are thinking outside the box. And so typically when they get a research grant, it's for about a 3 to 5 year period. And then once that is up, they file for a federal grant. And so to continue their research, and they do that through the National Health Institute and programs that are federally funded. So when it talks about the budget, we always try to make sure that, you know, our program, you know, the cancer programs that the researchers that we've been funding mm-hmm. are making sure they're getting covered. Mm-hmm. And our CEO, Gary Reedy, last year, I'm sure you guys heard about the cancer moonshot last year with Joe Biden yes. after he had lost his son.
Yeah.
They brought all these cancer organizations together to reaffirm their approach to cancer and to see what is it going to take for us to all work together mm-hmm. to. And our CEO, Gary Reedy, made the pledge to double our research over the next 5 years.
Wow, that's great.
So that is going to be
huge.
Phenomenal. Yes.
Absolutely. That yeah. is wonderful news.
It is. And, you know, so it's going to take a lot of hard work to get there, but mm-hmm. we're excited to see how that's going to look over the next 5 years.
So how does one get involved in that? Like, I mean, you said it's going to take a lot of work. So how does mm-hmm. somebody get involved in that?
In the research or the relay?
In the research, the relay, just being a part of this, finding a cure and working together.
Right. So if they would like to get involved with the relay,
mm-hmm.
they can go to our website, which is relayforlife.org
/
GTR Gardner MA.
All right. And we'll have that up on the screen so that you'll have that information.
Yes. And they can go there and they can read all about, they can join a team, they can create a team, they can donate to someone else's team. Okay. And they can donate to the event. They can read about all the upcoming fundraisers that we've got. And those can be everything from restaurants, dine-out nights, to bake sales, to... they've got all sorts of parties and things planned over the next several weeks leading up to Relay.
Okay.
So there's all sorts of different events that our teams have put together. We have over 125 teams currently registered for our Relay event this year.
Now, is that more or less than last year?
We're right on pace with where we were at this time last year.
Okay. And so it's still not too late to start a team, join a team.
Absolutely. You can still join. You can still come in, you know, come out into the event and just see what these teams are doing. You know, I always encourage folks who, especially if it's their first time really experiencing it,
mm-hmm.
just come out and see it. Come out and see what this is like.
And once you do, trust me, you'll come out every year.
Yes.
Because it's phenomenal.
And then we can talk to you about, let's get you that team and let's see what we can do, you mm-hmm. know. And the teams, they can be any kind of group. It can be a school, a church, a business, just you and 10 friends who, mm-hmm. and it doesn't even, you know, we have teams as small as 2 or 3 people to teams of 40 and 50 people. So, you know, you don't have, there's no minimum or maximum to be able to join us. So, you know, come out and just see what it's like. And then, you know, when you're there, you're going, okay, so who else do I know? Or who else is here that I know that I can join next year mm-hmm. and get involved with them next year?
Mm-hmm.
So the relay is it's one of those things, you just have to experience it. You have to come out and see what it's like, and then it becomes infectious.
It totally does. And it's from 6 p.m. on Friday night, June 9th, to 6 p.m. on Saturday, June 10th.
Yes.
And so...
We did try to stretch up to Sunday, but they all said no, so...
Yeah, after 24 hours, you're like done in. I know I've walked the track 5 or 6 hours mm-hmm. in a row. You're tired by the end, especially if it's cold and it's rainy, and it's just emotional.
It is.
So that's the other part.
It's draining, you know.
It is draining.
And, you know.
In a good way.
In a good way, absolutely. Right. But then I also look at all the work that they put into their campsites, and I go, this is going to be gone in 5 hours. Like, you know, you're like, you know, we need to stretch this out longer so that way the work that they do, you know.
Right,
doesn't go away that quickly.
Right. And then they have a lot of booths that you can go to, mm-hmm. and there's a lot of raffles that you can participate in. There's the Chinese auctions. There's all sorts of fundraising events on during those 24 hours as well.
Yes, yeah. The teams themselves will do a lot of the fundraising, you know, raffles and drawings and things like that. We do a day of drawing program where teams donate an item, mm-hmm. and we get about 75 to 100 items there that teams and folks can drop tickets on and try to get chances to win that. We even have a relay store where people can get, you know, their own relay gear. And, you know, if you came ready, you know, in shorts and a t-shirt and it's going to be 30 degrees at night, we've got a hoodie for you. We've got a jacket, you know, that you can purchase. Or if you came, you know, all bundled up thinking it was going to be cold and, you know, we've got, it's going to be 80 degrees. We've got that tank top and that t-shirt ready for you that you can get. So, that's, you know, great. We've got that ready for you. You know, is the experience you get at a relay event, you really can't substitute it with anything
absolutely.
Else.
Absolutely, absolutely. And then the bottom line is the money that's raised is doing good for people. And so tell me about the money. So if I were to donate, where is my money going?
So your money goes to the American Cancer Society. 76 cents for every dollar goes towards patient services and research. So when we talk about patient services, we're talking a program like our Hope Lodge program. So the Hope Lodge, if you're familiar with the Ronald McDonald House, is a place for an adult cancer patient to go and stay at while they're getting treatment at a local hospital. So we have one here in Boston. It's a 40-bed facility. So if it's 40 cancer patients and 40 caregivers. Now, the big difference though right now is, or with the Hope Lodge, is that the Hope Lodge is for adults only.
Okay.
So we don't take children. And the big reason is that the immune systems, when they go through treatment, is different for a child than it is for an adult. And if a child is having any trouble, we want them at that hospital. Mm-hmm. We want them staying at the hospital where they can get the immediate medical attention that they need. Whereas an adult can stay, you know, there, and if they are having trouble, they're not as far from the hospital, but we all know Boston traffic is not
conducive to getting to your appointments on time. Maybe?
Well, if there's an emergency, we'd, you know, again, right. We'd rather you be there. Mm-hmm. But with a child, we want to make sure that they're especially.
That makes sense.
So, but we have this facility is available. It's right on the Green Line.
In is Jamaica it free?
Park. It is free for an adult and caregiver to stay at. And since we opened it in 2008, it has saved over $20 million in patients' needs for lodging.
Wow.
Yes.
That is wonderful.
And so, I mean, there's always a waiting list. There's always someone who needs, and typical stay is about 6 weeks.
Okay. So it's a long term.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, while they're going through the treatment.
Yeah.
But then, you know, and the nice part is, you know, we're talking about the camaraderie with the survivors.
Yeah.
You've got 40 people who are all staying, or 80 people when you think about the caregiver. Patients and the caregivers, who are all staying together, who are all, you know, having dinner together or, you know, talking together. You know, they're right there in downtown Boston. There's actually a grill outside so they can, they will, if someone wants to grab some burgers and dogs and throw them on the grill, they have lunch, you know, do a little barbecue together.
So it kind of adds some normalcy to their life too. And that's really important because I know when I was going through my treatments every day for 4 weeks, I had to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning. I had to go in for my treatment. I was so sick on the way home. And then I had to get up the next day and do it all over again. So that would have been a great,
exactly.
a great option for
yes.
me.
And then the other, one of the other big programs we have is our Road to Recovery. And this is a program where volunteers will help. It's the Uber for cancer patients. They are able, you know, we have volunteers who will come and help you get to your treatments. They will come and pick you up, take you to the doctors. They may take you back, or there may be someone else who will come and bring you back. And here in Worcester County last year, we were able to help. It was around 750 rides we gave for about 125 patients.
And all of this is money raised from the relay.
Yes, that goes to support these programs for our patients. And you know, we want to do what we can to support them the best way we can. And these are just a couple of the many ways that we do. I mean, we have an 800 number that there is always somebody there to talk to. If you or a loved one needs support while you're going through treatment, it doesn't matter if it's 3 a.m. It doesn't matter if it's Thanksgiving. There's always a live person for you to talk to when you need someone the most.
Do you know that number? Or can you get me that number so we can put that on for the viewers? That would be great.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Awesome.
So,
see, now I was a co-captain for 2 years. I don't know all of these things. So now that I'm not a co-captain, I do participate every year, but maybe they've just all started since I've been a co-captain. As a co-captain 2009 and 2010.
Yep, a lot of these things, you know, are well, I think a lot of it is we're seeing where the success is with them.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there have been other programs in the past that may not have worked as well.
Mm-hmm.
So we're seeing, you know, these are some of the ones that we have more success with and that have stuck around. So mm-hmm. because we want to make sure that the programs we're providing are giving our patients the best opportunity. Mm-hmm. So.
So anything new on the horizon in terms of where they're going to put their money towards? Is there any new anything in the works like the Hope Lodge or the rides?
Well, right now there are a couple more lodges nationally that they are looking to build. So it's just about the funding and making sure it's there so that they can build them. Right now we have 32 Hope Lodges in the nation. We have two here in New England. One is in Vermont and one in Boston.
Okay.
So I do see, you know, a few more being built. But it is a major investment, you know, and so we're waiting to see where more of that comes into mm-hmm. and comes into play for our patients. And, you know, as far as other patient programs and systems in place, I think there's always the opportunity to look to see what else we can do. Right now, the big push right now is just with the screenings, is to make sure that, especially with where we're at with the Affordable Care Act, that people nationally who, you know, especially those who wouldn't normally go to treatment because they couldn't afford mm-hmm. the insurance beforehand, are able to go in and get the screenings done now. You know, somebody told me the other day, they see the number of diagnoses going up. And that's true.
And that's because there's better screening.
There's better screenings. But what you have to understand is that even if the diagnosis number is going up, it means that we're catching it earlier.
Mm-hmm.
We're seeing more stage ones than we are seeing stage threes and fours. So we're catching it earlier because people are, you know, they're going to their doctor. Whereas in the past, they may not have gone to their doctor unless it was an emergency because they didn't have the insurance for it.
Or maybe they didn't want to go to their doctor.
Oh, I got my checkups.
Or maybe they went to Google MD instead. Right, Sheila?
Right, Dr. Google.
And, you know, I really believe in being proactive, too. Mm-hmm. When I had my cancer, it was a fingernail infection. And because it was a fingernail infection, it was misdiagnosed. And I was having treatments that were actually ulcerating the tumor. And so I finally said as a nurse, this isn't working. I feel like I have cancer. And the doctor was like, now who has cancer in their fingernails? And I'm like, I don't know. I've known nobody who has cancer mm-hmm. in their fingernails. But in my gut, like you were saying, your intuition tells you. And I said, I really feel like I have cancer in my fingernail. And he's like, yeah, I don't think so. I said, would you do a biopsy? And I really was proactive and really pushing him to do the biopsy. And then when he did, he's like, I've never seen this before. I'm glad we did the biopsy. So I can't tell people enough, and I tell all my patients, you've got to be proactive. If you feel in your gut something's not right, then something probably isn't right. You need to go with that. And it's really important to be your own advocate, because I may not be here today if I did not demand the biopsy. And was proactive. So I feel like that's a really important point to get.
That's what they told me at the hospital. You're in charge of your care.
I believe that too. So I totally believe that.
Be informed and...
Yeah. And hopefully this show, one of the reasons I wanted to do this was to get the education out there, the importance of screening, the hearing from somebody who has been there, who had a normal test the year before, and then now is, you know, doing well. Thank goodness. I'm so happy to hear that, Sheila. Doing well right now. But, you know, I'm hoping this education really makes a difference in someone's life and that there's a message that really strikes them. Mm-hmm. Like, oh, maybe I need to go and have my skin checked. It's May, a skin awareness month. I really should go and have a skin check. I'm really just hoping that people get hope from this show, that people can survive cancer and live a very healthy life.
Yes.
And Sheila survived ovarian cancer. I've survived fingernail melanoma. And if you go to the relay, you're going to see a lot of other survivors and incredible stories of what people had to go through. And they're here today to share that story with people. So, you know, that was really my hope for having this show. And we can talk about Relay for Life. There's so much going on, but people can go to the website and yes. They can get all the information from the website.
Absolutely. Yeah. They go to the website. They even check us out on Facebook. You know, everyone's, you know, social media.
Mm-hmm.
They can just put it on their phone and check us out there. If they search for the Greater Gardner Relay on Facebook, they'll find our page and get all the information there as well. So it's we're really excited for this year's event. And again, we're hoping Mother Nature will help us out a little bit on it. And
I'm tired of getting soaking wet, rained and cold. But you know what? It doesn't really dampen the spirits because everybody just keeps going. And there's a lot of fun things. You get your little bead every time you do a lap. And you now, if you're not on a team, can you still walk?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Because every hour, the whole relay, the whole idea behind relay is that you're actually, someone is on the track from your team every hour for that 24 hours, right?
Yes.
And so, you know, you can still join. You can, even if you're not on a team, can you donate that day?
Yep.
Okay,
yes, so. Yes, we'll be doing donate, you know, they can drop donations off. They want to donate towards a team. They want to donate to the event. They go to our registration tent and they can help them out with that. You know, it's an amazing event and I'm really looking forward to
it.
It
really is. And I'll definitely be there. And, so Sheila.
This will be my first year.
And Sheila and I will be walking together. Yeah. Absolutely. Wonderful. And so hopefully we're going to see a lot of you there. And Sheila, that is awesome news that your last CAT scan was very promising. Mm-hmm. What are they saying about your prognosis?
They haven't really said, like, you know, much about that. You know, obviously I'm not at the point where I'm operable. So, I mean, that's my goal, either that or to get in a clinical trial. I've been working with a Dr. Cleary at Dana-Farber, and he's great. You know him?
I've heard of him, yes.
Yeah, he's awesome. They actually had a cancer, family cancer forum last month, because last month was colorectal cancer awareness. And it was totally free, and it was so informative, and like a lot of doctors were there.
So what's it going to take for you to get into a clinical trial?
Well, I mean, the metastases in my abdomen, those all have to resolve.
But this is looking very promising.
Yeah.
So we're going to keep praying for you. You know, I'm living proof that you can beat a rare cancer. And you just got to stay hopeful, positive. I think attitude is really a very important part of beating cancer. Do you agree?
Definitely. I just take it day by day and I just try to get as much out of the day as I can.
Yeah. And everyone, I really believe, not just because I'm a cancer survivor, but we all should be living like today's our last day and live our best day every day and do the best thing that we can do to take care of ourselves so that if we ever do get that call that says you have cancer, you eat, you've been eating right, you've been exercising, you've been doing all of your screenings, and you're ready to take on that challenge. I think that's a really important thing because I was healthy before, and the treatments that I had to go through, as you know, Sheila, they're very grueling and they take its toll. And just being a nurse, I really believe that people really, if you take care of your body now, it's going to decrease your risk. And if you end up having to go through this, that you will be able to tolerate your treatments and beat cancer. And all the great research that the relay is funding. So exciting. That is wonderful.
It is. You know, the work that we're able to do. And just to talk a little bit about the research.
Okay.
You know, our researchers, you know, we fund here, I was talking before, about 83 grants. Several of them are what we call non-site specific. And so what it is not necessarily the cancer is looking to treat, but also how do we take care of the family? You know, when a family member, a loved one is diagnosed, it's not just that person that is affected. It is their family. It is their friends. You know, and so we look into treatments to how do we best support, you know, everybody who's involved, and work with them and help them feel supported. And, you know, if you're diagnosed, you know, in an area, you know, how do we support you? You know, is it with an app or, you know, with everyone these days with the electronics, you know, and giving them the support that way? Is it, you know, trying to get them to treatment? You know, what is it that people need? Not just the patient, but the loved ones that are going into it. I mean, you know, we talk about the caregiver lap. and what caregivers go through. You know, as much as wonderful as the survivor camaraderie is, that caregiver camaraderie is also very important, because, you know, and a caregiver can be, doesn't always be a parent. It can be a child.
That's right.
You know, or a sibling, or
grandparent, friend.
Absolutely.
Co-worker.
So yeah. You have that, you know, that attachment, and, you know, to try to talk to a child, or, you know, child is there for their parent while also going to school, or, mm-hmm. you know, trying to do things. It's, you know, what is it that they need mm-hmm. while they're going through it? You know, because for them, that can be a lifestyle change or a life-changing experience mm-hmm. for them as well.
So the bottom line is there's resources for both the patient and the caregiver, and they can go to the American Cancer Society website as well.
Yes.
And get a lot of information.
Yeah, they just go to cancer.org.
Okay.
There's all sorts, and there's information on the number I was telling you about before,
yeah.
and all sorts of different things that they can get information on, because it is important, you know, to not just treat the cancer, but to treat everyone that's going through it.
Mm-hmm. And that, and everyone meaning everyone,
yes.
not just the patient. I know at Mass General, they really do a great job of including the whole family and everything mm-hmm. that's going on in your life. Because you had a life before you had cancer, and cancer doesn't define you.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, all of a sudden you're functional and you have this job and you've got this family and you're going and doing all of these extracurricular activities, and then you get a phone call and all of a sudden that all stops.
Mm-hmm.
And that's very difficult to deal with at times. So they treat the whole family. From my experience there, they were unbelievable.
And that's what's important is,
yeah.
you know, some may say, well, it's just, you know, it's not just your organ or
mm-hmm.
where it is that you have cancer, but it's treating everyone else who's involved with it. Because, you know, when you hear those words, it doesn't just, you know, you've got a loved one, you have loved ones who are with you while you're going
mm-hmm.
through it. They need the support as
right.
well.
And it's the mind-body connection, too.
Mm-hmm.
I know at Mass General, they have a mind-body clinic, and they got me right in there.
Mm-hmm.
Because you treat the whole, you treat the mind, the body, because they're all connected. And so it's not just targeting the cancer, like you say. It really is the emotional part of it, the spiritual part of it, the physical part of it. It's
yep.
all a package.
And, you know, we're very fortunate here in the Gardner area with two phenomenal hospital systems, Haywood Hospital, which actually has two locations, one in Gardner and one in Athol, that both have full-on oncology programs, as well as at UMass Memorial in the Leominster-Fitchburg area.
Mm-hmm.
And they do great programs with the body. They have free Reiki programs, massage programs, all that for survivors. So, you know, we're very fortunate that we have systems like this right here
mm-hmm.
in our area.
Mm-hmm.
On top of everything in Boston.
Right.
And Worcester. You know, Worcester's got St. Vincent's as well as UMass Memorial down there as well. So
mm-hmm.
we're very fortunate here in Massachusetts
yeah,
with the systems
are.
We have.
So we should be using those resources.
Absolutely.
So,
absolutely.
Well, you know, we could talk about this forever because it's definitely dear to your heart and my heart and so many others out there. So, but unfortunately we have to wrap it up for today. But you know what? I'm just so grateful that you came on the show, and what awesome information that you shared with everybody. And we're going to have the numbers for you. Come out to the relay on June 9th and 10th. Support those if you're not involved in cancer. I'm so happy for you, but come out and support those that are, and just enjoy the event. It's amazing. And Sheila, we're going to pray for you. And I'm so happy to hear that your results are improving, and that our dollars are helping people like Sheila and myself. And I just want to thank the viewers for tuning in today. And I hope that the message, you took something important out of the message, and maybe it doesn't affect you, but talk to those that you love. Make sure they have their screenings. Make sure they use the resources out there, because they're out there for a reason to help us. So use those resources and participate in the relay. And
we hope to see you there.
We hope to see you there. Absolutely. So thank you again for your time. Sheila, thank you for coming in. I know you don't
You're
feel
welcome.
Well, but I think sometimes hearing it from someone who's going through that, it gives hope to people.
Mm-hmm.
And your good news totally should give hope to people.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you very,
thank you
very
for
much.
Having us.
And just remember to live your best life every day starting today. This is Sherry Keating, Talk Me Healthy,
And we'll have you tune in next month. We'll have a show on cardiac rehab and cardiac disease. So I hope to see you back then. Thank you and have a great day.